you know, where is the, is there a greater ownership of church direction and church vision? You know, I mean, as a Methodist church, we are used to pastors coming and going, and often we just wait for pastors, you know, whoever is the new pastor, to come in and then set the direction and the vision. But I think this does not have to be the case, right? Right? It has to, because no matter how holy the pastor is, no matter how so-called good the pastor is, he's not connected. I mean, he's not as grounded and as rooted as you are, who have been in the church for many years, who know what has been going on and all that. So going forward, I hope for the next chapter, right, the next chapter of Holy Covenant, I want to involve the church in you are going to have an opportunity to be involved in conversations, in setting, seeking God together for the direction of the church, right? And I think you have a more vested interest than even the pastor, right? Because you are here. This is your community. This is where you are. This is where you have been baptized. This is where you have pledged your membership. And so let's have greater ownership of this vision of where the church is going and what God has called us to do. You know, we have talked about finding your place in God's big kingdom. So which part of God's kingdom? We can't do everything, right? God's kingdom is so big, so wide. But which part does he want us as Holy Covenant to do? And it has to do with what we have in our hands, as we have looked at in the sermon. And it has to do with where we are, right? In Dover, in Jurong East, in the school. And so the next chapter of Holy Covenant, right, I hope to involve us. And so I want you to, I mean, as time passes, the plans will be unveiled. I will be interviewing some of you. I'll be inviting you all to join discussion groups to participate, you know, in seeking God for the direction and the church, right? And so what I want us to do right now is pray for yourself, right? Pray for yourself. You know, what does God want you to do in this church? You know, how does God want you to be involved? And children too, right? You are involved, okay? You are not sitting there you are not just watching, right? You are not just a bystander. You too, right, are part of this church. And God has a role for you to play as well, right? So I want us to take some time to pray and ask God, what do you want me to do in this church? And I don't just mean, oh, serving here, serving there. That's not important, but what is it, you know, and what is it that God gets you excited about God's kingdom, you know, and as a church we can be involved in. So pray for your own heart, your own part in this, your own heart and your own part in this envisioning, in this exercise, right? And more details will be unveiled very soon, but I just ask you to just take some time to come before God to pray, right, and bring your own heart before God and ask God, what is the part you want me to play in this? I am part of this church, so what do you want me to do, right? So let's go to God in prayer, and then we will end this time by praying the Lord's Prayer together. Begin to round up our prayers. Let us join our hearts to pray the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 16 to 18. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. This is the word of God.
Good morning, Church. Once again, welcome to Holy Covenant's Methodist Church service. Can you remember how old you were when you began to ask the question, why? I think it's a question that parents of kids or even teenagers get very tired of answering, isn't it? Mommy, why is the sky blue? Papa, why can't I go out with my friends? Why can't I stay overnight at my friend's house? Why does Coco get this but I don't? Why so long we still haven't reached our destination? The why questions seem to be endless once your kids learn how to talk, once your kids learn how to ask the why questions. I think as adults, we too have many why questions. Except we probably are not as irritating or annoying or trying as the kids, right, in asking them. Our need to know why actually comes from being created by God as rational creatures, right? And so we tend to ask why, right? We want to know the purpose, we want to know the reason why things happen. And one of the loudest questions that we all must have at some point in our lives is, why is there so much suffering in this world? Why did so and so, you fill in the blanks, right? Have to suffer so much. Why do I have to go through this? Today we come to the second sermon on the topic of death and suffering. And I'd like to explore the reason for suffering. And whatever reasons we can offer for suffering in this life, it must first come from our biblical worldview, our Christian worldview. Right? This is something that I've mentioned in God's grand story, Finding Your Place, the first year of the sermon series, Finding Your Place, and its understanding is so important that it impacts our whole lives as Christians, not just the reason for suffering, right, but our whole life as a Christian. We understand this to be our worldview, right? So let's have a quick revision. The world as originally created by God was a world without death and suffering. Right? So we read about this in Genesis, when God, Genesis chapter 1 and 2, right? When God created everything on heaven and earth. Now this is important, right? The world originally was without death and suffering. This is important because it tells us that evil and suffering that we see today around us is not part of God's original design. Right? It is not part of God's original design. This means that even what our Hawkins service member, Madam Chua Siu Hua, or Siu Hua Ji, even what she experienced a peaceful death recently at 90 years old. Even that, right, is not the way things were meant to be. Right now we look at her, wow, very good, you know, 90 years old, passed away quite peacefully, right? And we long for this kind of death, right? But bear in mind that the world as God originally created, even death is not part of God's plan, right? That this world was created by God also reminds us that we do not own this world. God created this world and he continues to sustain it. Night and day, summer and winter, the movement of the earth around the sun, all this tells us God is still very much involved in the world. Now we all know also what happened very soon after creation. Came the fall. Right, the fall of humankind in the Garden of Eden means that the original design of the world is broken. God's original design for this world is broken. Right, in the garden, men and women were called to work, to care for and to cultivate the earth. When Adam and Eve sinned, their work was cursed, such that now they would experience thorns and thistles while trying to produce food from the ground. This means, again, that life after the fall is far from God's original intention. Right? It's far from God's original intention. By right, hard work should always lead to prosperity. Right? If a person is willing to work hard, right, you should prosper. Right? But we know that sometimes you can work hard, but injustice or disaster can wipe away all your hard work. So because of the fall, our relationships are broken at every level and are in need of God's redemption, in need of God's restoration. So what are the levels at which our relationships are broken? Firstly, our relationship with God. Secondly, our relationship with one another. Thirdly, our relationship with the earth that God has made. And fourthly, even our relationships within ourselves, right, that leads to all kinds of disorders, right, within ourselves. Even, all the mental disorders and whatnot. Okay? So that is the fall. But God did not leave us to face a broken and fallen world on our own. He took on human flesh and died on the cross. That's where Christ came in. Through the person and work of Jesus Christ, God is reconciling the world at every level back to himself. All the levels that I've mentioned that were broken, that experienced broken relationship, God is now, through Christ, reconciling back to himself. So through Christ, God shows us that he is a God who suffers with us and for us. And so, yes, we may not know the reason, we may still not know the reason why God allows suffering and evil to continue, or why it is so random. But now at least we know what the reason is not. It cannot be that he does not love us. It cannot be that he does not care. Just look at the cross. Right? So Jesus is evidence that God loves us, that God cares for us, that he is a God who suffers for us and suffers with us. Right? So even if we may not know, we still cannot figure out the reason why we are going through this suffering. Right? Know this, it cannot be that God does not love you. Right? And Christ's coming, we know, marks the beginning of God's kingdom on earth. Right? Christ's death and resurrection meant that it was now possible for God's kingdom to come, that his will can be done on earth as it is in heaven, but not completely yet. So we look forward to that day where it will be complete. That's what we call the consummation, the marriage of heaven and earth. Heaven and earth joining, being joined together. The Bible tells us that Christ will come again a second time to judge both the living and the dead. And when that happens, the restoration will be complete. Earth and heaven will be joined perfectly. When that happens, there will be no more suffering, no more death, no more pain, no more tears, no more evil. Many people today complain when they hear about this coming judgment of God. They complain. They cannot believe in a God who judges and punishes people. But my friends, if there is no final judgment, if we cannot cling on to this belief that there's going to be a final judgment, what about all the enormous amount of evil and injustice that we see in our world today? See, if there is no final judgment, there's only two options left for us as human beings. One is that we lose all hope. We lose all hope and we just end up in despair. The other option is we take vengeance upon ourselves. So we see, you do wrong to me, I'm going to do wrong to you. You hit me, I'm going to hit you back. Right? If there's not going to be any final judgment, can you see that these are the only two options left to human beings? Right? Either we are so weak and powerless, we cannot do anything against the injustice being done to us. So we just end up in despair. Oh, my life is like that. Life sucks. I just accept it. And I live in despair all my life, all the rest of my life. Or I'm strong enough, you hit me, I'm going to hit you back. I'm going to take vengeance. Turn to vengeance for myself. Right? And so the consummation, the fact that there is a coming judgment, the fact that Christ is going to come again to make all things right, actually enables us to live with hope and grace. It gives us the motivation to work for justice. Even though we may have very little success right now, we know that justice will finally be established fully and perfectly. And when Christ comes again, all that is wrong will finally be made right. That is what enables us as Christians to live with grace and hope. So this is our biblical worldview as Christians. It is what we believe to be true about our world and how we must live our lives. The church today lives in the time between Christ and consummation, between Christ's first coming and second coming. So it is what I've mentioned before as a now and not yet time. It is a now and not yet time. So what do I mean by now and not yet? Because when Christ first came on earth, His kingdom on earth has started, right? But it has not come in a full and complete way, right? But as Christians live holy lives and learn to flourish in their place, the world catches a glimpse of how beautiful and glorious God's kingdom can be. And so with this understanding at the back of our minds, allow me to offer three reflections that has to do with the reason for suffering. First, the evil that is within us. A thought about evil. J.R.R. Tolkien, the author of Lord of the Rings, he mentions, he has this quote in his book. He says, "Always after a defeat and a respite, evil takes another shape and grows again." Right? Isn't it true when we look at the history of the world? A large segment of humanity looks to scientific progress and technological advancement to eradicate, to get rid of world problems. Right? The internet, for example, has changed the way we live. Banking, shopping, watching movies, and most recently, working and Zooming can all be done from the comfort of the home. The internet has certainly brought about improvements in life, convenience in life. But at the same time, we also know it is being abused for evil purposes. For example, internet pornography is a huge business. And there is also the existence of the dark web where all sorts of illegal and immoral activities happen. Or take nuclear energy as another example. It is a great source of power when it is harnessed properly. But yet countries and terrorist organizations can also use it to develop weapons of mass destruction. So what Tolkien has observed is true. When a new development seems to bring about some improvement in our life, but it pushes back evil in one form, it will somehow find a new way to assert itself again. Just like this game that I don't know if you have played in the arcade before, where you try to hammer all the things down. You hammer one fella down, the other will pop up, right? So that's like what Tolkien is saying about evil, right? And why is this so? Why is this so? It is because the evil and darkness of this world comes to a great degree from within us as a result of the fall. Again, so you must have the biblical worldview at the back of your mind, right? As a result of the fall, the evil and darkness of this world comes to that great degree from within us. Many of us will consider, you know who this is? This is the white supremacist Brenton Tarrant. Right? Many of us will consider him a monster. Last year, on 15th of March, he gunned down 51. He shot 51 people in two mosques in New Zealand. Right? Killed 51 people. Now, there is no death penalty in New Zealand, So he was sentenced to life imprisonment without chance of parole. Right, he's the first person in the history of New Zealand to receive this sentence. So the judge remarked in sentencing him, "Your crimes are so wicked that even if you are detained until you die, it will not exhaust the requirements of punishment. Even if you are detained until you die, it will not exhaust the requirements of punishment." But the fall reminds us that evil actions, even those that we would consider extreme, like that of Brenton Tarrant, they are not perpetuated by monsters. Right? Which part of him looks like a monster? He looks like an ordinary human being like you and I, right? But so these are perpetuated by fellow human beings for whom the possibility of redemption is always real and available. So we can argue that there is no category of evil persons or subhuman beings or monsters who carry out evil actions. To a degree, all human beings are capable of the most dreadful acts of evil. The line between good and evil runs through the heart of every human being. Do you agree with me so far? Right? If you agree with me, then you also have to agree so that if Christ had come in power to destroy evil wherever he found it, then he would have to destroy us too. Right? We would also have to be destroyed. Because evil is also deeply rooted in human hearts after the fall. But instead, Christ came in weakness and he went to the cross in order to pay for our sins so that someday he will return to wipe out evil without having to judge us as well. So that someday he can return to wipe out evil without having to judge us. Now, I know I said last week that my focus in this series is not answering this question, why does a good God allow evil and suffering? My focus is on how we as Christians can keep our faith in the midst of suffering and evil. But I will make this one point. Okay? A philosophical argument is always this, right? There's this philosophical argument that you can't miss, right, when you talk about evil and suffering. First, right, so this is the proposition, right? If God is truly good, he will not want evil to exist. Now, but if God is all-powerful, he will not allow evil to exist. Right, you get the argument, right? If God is very good, if God is good, right, he will not want evil to exist. Right? If God is all-powerful, then he will not allow evil to exist. But the fact is, evil exists in this world. And therefore, does it mean this? God is either not good or not all-powerful. Because he cannot be good, both good and all-powerful at the same time. Right? If God is both good and all-powerful at the same time, then evil will not exist in this world. This is the philosophical argument, right? But can you see that this argument has a hidden assumption? Right? And this assumption is that God does not have any good reasons to allow evil to exist. There is an assumption in this argument, right? And the assumption is that God does not have any good reasons to allow evil to exist. See, if God has good reason, even one good reason for allowing suffering and evil, then there will be no contradiction between his existence and at the same time together with evil, that evil being present in the world. And so for a skeptic, for a doctor to prove his case, he must show that God cannot have any good reason for allowing suffering and evil. But it is almost impossible to prove that. When we look at our own lives, we often allow suffering in order to bring about some greater good. Doctors, for example, often inflict painful procedures and treatments on people. Why? All for the greater good and better health and longer life of their patients. Parents who punish their children's bad behavior may appear to be causing pain to the kids, especially from the child's perspective. But the alternative is that your child will grow up spoiled And then when he becomes, or he or she becomes an adult, will be uncontrollable. And that will definitely bring about more suffering. So since we who are made in God's image, we understand that sometimes we must go through pain in order to experience a greater good, why can't God have the same reason as well? Or why can't God have a reason that we may not understand? But there is a further assumption behind this assumption. Right? The assumption that we mentioned earlier is that God does not have any good reasons to allow evil to exist. But if you think about this, examine this assumption a bit more, you find that there is actually an assumption behind the assumption. The assumption is that I must be able to understand the reason. Right? So if I can't see any reason why God may allow this evil to happen, then probably he doesn't have any reason. That is the assumption behind the assumption. But what about this thought, brothers and sisters? This assumption is obviously false. Why? Because if God is infinitely knowledgeable, if God is an infinite God, why can't he have good reasons for allowing evil that you cannot think of? Why can't he have a good reason for allowing evil that you can't think of? Let's use this illustration. Let's say you own a dog, a big dog, like a golden retriever, or the Chiang Mai kids, your thing, blessing, think of a home cage for a blessing. Right? You have a big cage or a dog house for your dog at home. Now, if this morning before coming to church, you look inside the cage and you don't see blessing or you don't see the golden retriever, it is probable that there's no golden retriever in the cage, so it's not there. Right? Because if blessing was there, or if the golden retriever was there, you would have seen it because it's so big in the cage. But can you look into the cage at the same time and tell me that there is no bacteria in the cage? You can't, right? Nobody can look inside this cage and tell me there's no bacteria. Because even if there was bacteria, you wouldn't be able to see them because they are too small to be seen. But yet they exist inside this cage as well. So the question is, are God's reasons for allowing evil and suffering more like the golden retriever or more like the bacteria? If God is infinitely knowledgeable, why can't he have good reasons for allowing evil and suffering that we cannot think of, that we cannot understand, that we cannot imagine? Right? Is God's reasons for allowing evil and suffering more like the golden retriever or more like the bacteria that you cannot see but still exists? Right? So that is another thought I want to leave with you. Now let me share a third reflection related to the above. Right? And it has to do with this question. Have you made God in your image? Is God's purpose to bless you with health and wealth above all else? Is God here to bless all the plans that you make? Is God supposed to act the way you expect him to? Because you prayed, because you gave a huge offering, because you served in LCEC? Suffering often makes us disillusioned with God. A man who is mourning the death of his baby daughter confessed the depth of his loss. He said, "I don't know what to believe anymore. I don't know whom to pray to or what to pray. I tried to be a good person. I did the best I knew how, and it didn't do a bit of good. If God is going to let something like this happen, then what's the use of believing at all?" But disillusionment, in a sense, is not so bad. Disillusionment, as the word suggests, is the loss of illusion about ourselves, about the world, about God. And while it is almost always painful, it is not a bad thing to lose the lies that we have mistaken for the truth. Right? If this disillusionment means that we recognize, oh, that was a lie that I believed in, then it helps to push us closer to the truth. Right? This illusion, we come to understand that God does not conform to our expectations. We glimpse our own relative size in the universe and we see that no human being can say who God should be or how God should act. This illusion, we find out what is not true and are set free to seek what is, if we dare. Did God fail to come when I called? And perhaps God is not a servant. So who is God? Did God fail to punish my enemy? Then perhaps God is not a policeman. So who is God? Did God fail to make everything turn out right? And perhaps God is not a repairman, not a fixer. So who is God? Over and over again, our disappointments draw us deeper into the mystery of God's being and doing. Every time God declines to meet our expectations, another one of our idols is exposed. Another curtain is drawn back so that we can see what we have propped up in God's place. No, that is not God. So who is God? This is a question of a lifetime. And the answers are never big enough or finished. Maybe it is not God who failed us, but we who have failed God by limiting him to our own poor and stingy imaginations and expectations. God is greater than my imagination, wiser than my wisdom, and more dazzling than the universe, as present as the air I breathe, and utterly beyond my control. So this third reflection reminds us, we are the ones made in God's image, not the other way around. Many of us try to make God in our image. Oh God, I make plans to do all this. Can you please bless my plans? God, please heal me. Right? God, whatever. Right? God does not exist to make your life smooth sailing. That would be a God made in your own image, according to your own expectations. No, God is a God who is utterly beyond our control. And he calls us to follow him. As C.S. Lewis remarked elsewhere in his Chronicles of Narnia, he is not a safe God, but he is a good God. God is not safe because he may not always grant you health and wealth and smooth sailing, but he is a good God. He is a good God. And his intentions for you are always for good and not for evil. Our passage this morning reads, therefore we do not lose heart, for though our outer man is decaying, yet our inner man is renewed day by day. For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory, far beyond all comparison. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I don't think in a short sermon or in a short series we can answer or fully answer the question why there is death and suffering. But I hope the reflections shared above has been helpful to your own understanding. And in closing, let me just draw two truths from this morning's passage. So Apostle Paul tells us, all our suffering on earth, including our death, is momentary and light compared to the eternal weight of glory waiting for us. This is not making light of any suffering that you may be going through now, but we need to understand that when we finally enter into God's eternal glory, it will be so wonderful, it will be so full, so complete, so heavy as it were, and of substance, that even the worst suffering we have to go through in our lives would be, if you compare the weight, would be like cotton wool compared with a heavy cast iron. Right? That's not even the full comparison, I believe. Right? So, when we finally enter into the eternal glory that God has prepared for us, we will find that it is so full, so complete, and so heavy that even the worst kind of suffering that we have to go through in our life here would be like cotton wool compared to that cast iron of eternal glory. So that's the first point I want to remind us from today's passage. The second point is that none of the suffering you go through here on earth is ever wasted. So even though the Apostle Paul considers all our suffering on earth as light and momentary, they are producing for us an eternal weight of glory, far beyond all comparison. And we must remember, Apostle Paul himself went through a lot of suffering. So he definitely is not making light of other people's suffering. Oh yeah, you're weak, you cannot take this suffering. No, it's not that case. Right? Paul himself went through beatings, went through imprisonment, went through shipwreck, went through lots of suffering in his own life. And yet, he considers all our suffering on earth as light and momentary. Why? Because they are producing for us an eternal weight of glory, far beyond all comparison. So you see, no matter how heavy or light your suffering here on earth is, it is producing for you an eternal weight of glory, beyond all comparison. So it means that none of the suffering that you go through here on earth is ever wasted. Right? None of the tears that you cried is for nothing. Right? God sees every tear you cry. Right? God knows every pain that you go through. And it is all achieving for you, producing for you an eternal weight of glory far beyond your imagination, far beyond all comparison. Brothers and sisters, do you believe that? Right? My aim this morning is not to list down all the possible reasons for suffering in this life. I don't think there's any human being alive or dead who knows all the reasons. And that would take far longer than one sermon anyway. But my prayer and hope is that you have been challenged to think differently about suffering and death. That you have been challenged as well to give up your wrong ideas about God and to really seek the real God who is there. Let us go to God in prayer. A lot has been said this morning, and I just give you some time to wrestle with some of these thoughts, some of these ideas that you may be hearing for the first time. And ask that God, through His Holy Spirit, will make it clear to you. God, we come before you. We who are made in your image. And yet, how often, Lord, we try to make you in our image instead. And once again, God, we confess that even if we cannot see any possible reason for suffering and evil that we may have to go through, or a loved one has to go through, it does not mean that you have no reason for that suffering. So God, we pray, you enlarge our imagination. Forgive us, God, if we have limited you by our stingy and poor imagination. Help us to realize that you are not a safeguard. It is not a safeguard that we follow, but you are definitely a good God. You love us. You show that to us on the cross. And because of that, give us the courage to follow you wherever you may lead us. For all our suffering on earth is light and momentary compared to the eternal weight of glory that you have prepared for us. We praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our hearts for tithes and offerings. There are a few ways to give to the church. You can scan the code, go to the signs, or write a check. us give thanks. Heavenly Father, you are the creator and source of all things good. You have showered us with greatness and love. Look into our hearts and receive this heartfelt thanksgiving we offer to you. May these gifts multiply and be a blessing to your works and plans on earth. Forever in your glory, Lord, in Jesus' most holy name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Welcome again to all of you. Now is the time for family news. The bulletin is available online as well, so you can scan the QR code for that. So a couple of announcements. We're still having worship on site. Just a reminder to all of us to remember to register for service by Thursday. I know I always forget, but Thursday is the last day to register for service on Sunday. Yeah. Monthly church prayer meeting will be on the 27th of October at 7:45. It will be held via Zoom, and we really encourage you all to come together to pray for the needs of the church and your own needs as well. Okay, the Methodist Walk 2021 will be held in March next year, and it's organized by the Methodist Schools Foundation every 2 years. So it's CAC's turn to underwrite the cost of the event, which is 100K. So if you want to donate, please contact Reverend Edmund. And all these donations are tax deductible. So all the money will go to funding schools, Methodist schools, to achieve excellence and to help the kids in these schools. Okay, the 45th session of the CAC will be held from the 17th to the 19th of November via Zoom this year. So all delegates, both ministerial and lay, you need to register your attendance by the 19th of October, Monday. So this is a new year, right, for the new quadrennium. So there'll be elections for that. So do keep the conference in prayer. Next announcement, baptism, confirmation or membership or transfer of membership. If you would like to do any of the above mentioned during Christmas this year, please obtain a form from Reverend Edmund or Preacher Florence so we can make arrangements for the classes. The Methodist message is online. You can go to this website to read some of the updates and pieces that are there. And finally, we give thanks for those who have completed exams, but we want to continue to uplift those who are still in the midst. So Paris and Ansel, do keep them in your prayers and pray that God will really sustain them through this time. So we come to the end of service. Please rise for the hymn of sending forth.
Imagine so great a mercy, what heart could find?
receive the benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you, now and always. Amen. Please be seated. Service is over. God bless you. See you next week.